Alrighty, folks, we're back again. I got the wrong freaking address. I don't know why I got 240 Montgomery stuck in my head, but anyway, we're back. And there are indeed people out here. And the address was 456 Montgomery, not 240. So, here I am. I'm making my way down here. I think I'm going to wait. Can't be in too big of a hurry. I've been to this area a million times and totally forgot about where the Israeli consulate was. Huh. Oh yeah, I've got plenty of cops down here. Got more cops than demonstrators, looks like. As usual, for certain protests, the pigs always come over prepared. And yes, indeedy, they are over prepared, as you can see. Did I see any noticeable cops that like beating people up? Well, just give it a minute. Yeah, it looks like they got this stupid protest fence up here. There are a few people here. This is Freeman Sullivan, broadcasting at bandmuser.com. Switching over from Ustream today, because this software is a lot more robust, and saves on batteries, has Zoom capabilities, and a bunch of other new things that I haven't had a chance to play around with. So, I'm real excited about that. I'm going to let out of breath. We're down here in downtown San Francisco on a lovely evening. About 65 degrees outside. And looking at the police overkill. Because you know they're going to protect Israelis. The Israeli consulate here. Above and beyond all other consulates, I might add. Politics, right? Anyway, this protest is about the torture and murder of Palestinian prisoners who are being held in detention without a trial, without any due process, and being tortured to death. And already there's been several Palestinian men who have been tortured while they were in jail. So, that's pretty much what I was reading into the Facebook page that announced this protest. Always got plenty of security on hand for this. A friend of the Israelis. I don't support Zionists myself. I really don't like being accused of being anti-Semitic when I'm against the fucking policies of the Israeli government. Because the Israeli government definitely needs to be stopped. The United States government needs to stop sending aid to Israel because Israel's hell-bent on war. Right now they're waging war on the Palestinian people. They refuse to recognize any of the Palestinian organizations that are, most notably, what is it, Hamas? Definitely anti-Hamas. the one negotiated with Hamas, despite the fact that Palestine is elected, legally elected Hamas as their government. And I don't really like to get too involved in the politics of Israel, generally speaking, because it's just too Byzantine to even want to talk about. But I do not support the Israeli government myself personally. And the United States needs to stop shipping arms overseas altogether. Period. To all countries. Why are we, it's all about the money, you know? How much money can we make selling arms to different nations around the world? So, and the United States is the number one exporter of arms. So yeah, right now we have more cops and demonstrators. Then about this protest from a Facebook page. It seems like people are still getting here. There's maybe a dozen and a half, 20 people, and about 50 cops. Because I know there's some around the corner here, I'm sure of it. Yeah. We're here at the Israeli consulate in beautiful downtown San Francisco. It's a lovely evening out this evening.
All right. Yeah.
So if you got any questions, just log on to the stream and I'll be happy to answer them. Got anything you want to say or whatnot? So glad I don't have to work down here anymore. I used to run this rat race every day. Thank God I don't have to do it anymore, folks. Looks like people are slowly trickling in. Not a whole lot going on right now. God, I can think of all the places I protested around here. Citibank, down the street here, in Wells Fargo, and around the corner of Wells Fargo headquarters and Bank of America. God, this place is really disgusting. This is Wall Street West, folks. Yeah, 456 Montgomery is the Israeli consulate. They're probably upstairs. I used to work in this building, believe it or not. Oh, God, I remember those dark days. You know, when you're on the workforce today, you're not going to make a lot of money doing anything. You're not part of the 1%. I was making half-ass money for a job. You had at least a master's degree. Oh, God. Pipping myself out to the capitalist man. Well, I'm glad I don't have to do that anymore. And we got lots of pigs down here as usual. And it always makes you wonder if the Israelis have any snipers up in the building. I know that's kind of paranoid, but after the revelations about Occupy, I'm certainly not going to discount any kinds of attacks that are made on protesters and demonstrators. So I'm sure that Homeland Security is out here taking pictures of us all. Yeah, we're on Bambuser today, instead of Ustream. I just want to try out this software, and it seems to be a lot more robust, so I'm probably going to continue to use Bambuser instead of Ustream. And we're across the street from the Israeli consulate at 456 Montgomery Street in San Francisco. A few more protesters are showing up, about two dozen right now. Hopefully this will get a little more boisterous. Nice to be recognized, fellow occupier. Well, plenty of police, plenty of fence. The usual situation here in San Francisco. That the Israelis are pretty scared of us right now, I'm pretty sure. And as an anarchist, I do support the Palestinian cause, but I believe that the United States should stop all foreign aid, foreign military aid, to all countries around the world. Basically, it's used as an instrument to destabilize other countries. How much does it cost to have this many cops here? Let's see. The bigger cops make about $100,000 a year in San Francisco. So that works out to be about $300 a day. And there's 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 6, let's say 20, 25 cops times 300. So we're talking about $75,000 that's being spent on security for this event. It's a lot of money. Pretty quiet protest. Mostly everybody's standing around with their hands in their pockets. Kind of boring out here, actually. Police set up a little protest bin. They don't want this spilling out on a Montgomery Street. God forbid, traffic might get blocked. Yeah, personally, I get a little claustrophobic when I'm inside of a protest tent. How's it going?
Good. You seem to be able to predict relatively well how many people will show up by how many cops they sit. In my experience at these events.
$75,000. That's what it costs today for cops.
Yeah, I have no doubt.
Right. It's a lot of money.
You know,
can't be blocking traffic, oh my god.
Right.
Beautiful day though.
Yeah, it is a beautiful day. I actually just had a job interview across the street and I didn't notice as I was walking because I was reading the addresses on this side of the street. And then I walked out to the barricades and the cops. I thought I actually had another interview, but I scheduled two on top of each other on accident, so...
Looking for work,
happy,
huh?
Accident. Yeah, I mean, not too vigorously, like, I'm trying to find something that I'm going to want to stay out for 2 or 3 years. Which I have not wanted to.
I think I can count off every building. I've worked in almost every building down here at one point or another.
Yeah.
Glad I don't have to anymore.
They have some arrangement where...
Hey. Got a little wife out here. Yeah, how do you feel about being called anti-Semitic when you go to a protest against Israel? Isn't that the fucking...
Not my favorite thing.
Yeah, it's not. Isn't that like the pot calling the kettle black?
I mean, it's basically like it's almost like God was blown on the internet or something, right? It's just like you can't have the conversation. You can't really ask me why I'm here or what people are upset about. You're just saying, oh, and the people drive. We love it. Some of the local like Thai, like Zionist community members, the one black guy, when I see them like in their German car. Screaming at the people that are anti-Semitic, it's just like you are living in a hallucination. Even if I was wrong in a couple of data points that I misunderstood or something, I mean, there's an overwhelming pile of evidence about the reason the people are upset. You're hearing a Mercedes fan. There's nothing more than say this is a conversation that we need to have in this country a lot more often and not just say, like, oh, the Middle East is complicated. Like, well, people seem to agree that peace in the Middle East would be the greatest contributor to peace everywhere else because all of the conflicts sort of radiate out from who's on whose side there. And so if we could just arm all of that network, that would be great for everyone. But if we could just talk about it more for a little while, that would be a good start.
Yeah, because I called in to complain. And the guy literally accused me of being anti-Semitic from the consulate here, right? So.
What did you call it a complaint about?
Oh, it was about something that they bombing Gaza.
Oh, okay.
Right, and I said I was against it, and that I don't support it, and I don't think my government should support Israel. Well, you're just anti-Semitic, right?
No, not so much.
Yeah. I mean, don't they realize how much is better Israel would be better off if we didn't send them military aid?
I was having a conversation with someone the other day, and I was like, I understand why in the 40s, you know, Jewish people from Europe wanted
to have a homeland,
to
right?
Have a government that was run by Jewish people. I mean, I get it. There's great reasons to feel that way, but I just don't believe the solution that was brokered was the proper solution, and then to pretend that the solution that was brokered in the 40s is a continuation of an ages-old conflict. Well, everyone in the world has been in conflict since the beginning of time. I mean, you can't just say that. You can't just freeze everything the way it is now and then say, no more conflict. Anyone in conflict is bad. It's like, oh, you know, what about the rockets? Yeah, I mean, I imagine that's terrible. I imagine if I was in a town that was, you know, a few hundred yards away from a wall upon on the other side where people who lived in tents and shacks where we turned on the water a couple of hours a day and let I imagine over time that they would start acting out in measures of desperation that no sane person would believe are going to win you anything except satisfaction for a day. And I don't necessarily condone that, but I'm like, you know, if you're tired of people striking back at you, we don't have to talk about what their motivation is, because if we don't make it clear what's okay and what isn't okay, if you just don't make people feel desperate, you'll find yourself at the shit end of a lot less conflict.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I was watching on RT, they had a documentary about these Palestinian women. They had to sneak in.
As I drink a Coca-Cola.
Yeah, right. What are you doing, man? And Diet Coke at that.
I know.
That's poison.
Yeah, but it doesn't have aspartame.
It's got aspartame in it.
Yeah, I know. I choose cancer.
Which is even nastier. Now you got it all over your hands.
If I were a little older, I probably wouldn't choose cancer as a big fact.
Well, I'm smoking a cigarette, so. Nice that people are chanting.
Yeah,
kind of a light turnout.
Well, it's early yet. Usually the numbers go up. Everyone's always
late.
And so whenever I'm working with people to organize an action, I'm always like, when do you actually want this to happen? You need to announce it an hour beforehand. If you don't want people milling around, then announce the meeting place 6 blocks away beforehand and then mark. And tell everyone who's late to go to the place.
But well, I don't see any counter demonstrators out here. Usually there's a handful.
Yeah.
Which is good. They're just trolls. But yeah, killing people in custody is wrong.
Yeah.
I don't care what country's doing it.
Right. I mean,
South Africa.
You can set aside the grand question of the Palestinian conflict, and you can start to address some very serious policies that the nation who sits all day long claiming to be the more civilized place
ends up being more civilized.
Doing. And so it's like, I don't... There are transgressions on both sides of this conflict. There will be in any conflict once it escalates to a certain point over a certain amount of time, but like, I don't want to hear about the transgressions of the resistance until we hear about the transgressions of the
Oakland. Well, I've been thinking about this guy, this young black guy that got killed. He was at a high school dance in Oakland, and he was murdered by Oakland police. And it turns out that the guy who is the security for the school is now testifying that the police actually murdered this guy. And so he's come out and he's filed an affidavit stating that the police actually murdered this kid. So we got it right here in the Bay Area, just as well as everywhere else.
Oh, yeah. You know, sprinkled some crack on him, right?
Well, the kid didn't have any, the kid was clean.
Yeah.
Right? He was only like 15 years old. Yeah, I know.
But, yeah.
They do that, actually.
In Oakland, it's take the gun out of your sock and throw it next, wipe it off and throw it next. Oh, well, they had a gun. Why was it pointing away from you, 30 feet away on the street? But he dropped it when I shot him in the back.
But this guy, he's like...
And there's constantly the question of, who do you think it's possible that young man was trying to get rid of a piece of evidence that would get him in a lot of trouble and then surrender to you, or at least he knew you were probably going to catch him, and maybe, okay, I mean, maybe the guy should have had a gun, or, you know, but from what I can tell, it's very difficult to grow up in certain parts of Oakland and even not be involved in gangs or any other kind of organized crime and not be concerned for your own safety, because then you have no group protecting you, and, you know. Very complex issue to say, well...
Yeah, well, we don't have some police.
Not every high school kid that you find who's carrying a gun is the one who does the drive-by. Maybe some of them are worried about being able to get out in the middle of the street when there's a street fight, and the bullets start flying, and they just want to create a reason for no one to get anywhere near them. And I imagine the logic of a high school-aged person who's afraid of their life every day, then that's pretty sound.
Well, Oakland's off the hook, man.
Yeah.
Nah. No, I'm a journalist. I'm out here live streaming. Well, I support Jews, I just don't support Israel. Because I'm over here, I'm documenting. I'm out here reporting, I got people watching. I'm mainly here because of the police, actually. Yeah, keep them non-violent when they know they're being photographed.
This is a lesson that the Israeli police have been learning recently.
Oh yeah, when they get live streamed, they don't...
They just started getting live streamed,
you know. They're not as violent.
Shooting bullets.
It's always the response to a conversation that you don't have any facts to contribute.
Yeah, she's a nice lady too, huh?
Yes. You seem like a nice person except for being wrong. Not necessarily an asshole, but
yeah, well.
Buying the typical American story. I'm gonna find the story today and I'll come back.
Alright.
I just found your phone and I'm gonna stream my thing as well on 4G just to have some morning opportunity to
Yeah, I'm on 4G.
Video later.
Alright. Yeah, we're on a 4G network here. If you're going to be a live streamer, I recommend Metro PCS. The initial cost of the phone is a little higher because you're going to have to pay full price, but at $60 a month, it's a pretty good deal. And you get unlimited data with that. I have a little problem getting out of my Twitter feed for some unknown reason. Thank you. He's got some spirit. He likes people with spirit. Yeah, I'm out live streaming like 3 or 4 times a week now.
Yeah,
I'm switching over to band music.
That's gotta be a frustrating fight, like I haven't followed all the details, but...
What's CCSF?
It's like, yeah, it's the largest community college in the nation, but also...
Largest college in the nation.
At one location.
Yeah.
The Art Institute, where I also used to go, is the largest institution. Draw up to your parents' house. It's the largest college in the nation.
But that's the 1% thing is if they can privatize CCSF, they can hit anything.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right?
I mean,
we got
what I think is complex about it is having gone to CCSF, they definitely have a lot of problems, and I don't question the wisdom of someone who thinks that maybe their accreditation should be under review, but I think that the solution to that is to get rid of a lot of administrators.
Yeah, well... That's an A
organization. You replace them with someone else that's corrupt. I mean, when I first moved here from Texas and I started going there, I was so curious. I found out they had just done this big bond measure with technology and the arts and all of this stuff, and they built a fucking football stadium. And apparently, CCSF has one of the top community college football teams in the nation, and fitness is good. I learned yoga and other things, like at the gym there. It was super cheap, but great, but...
Sports are the expensive.
Coming from Texas to go to a school in San Francisco and then find out immediately that everything sucks and it's broken and poor because they spent all the money on a football
stadium.
But you couldn't shut me in about that shit for 2 years.
Yeah, so students are facing a real uphill struggle. But they just introduced a new bill in the California legislature yesterday. State AB 1199, which is going to ensure, hopefully when it passes, that it will ensure funding for City College in perpetuity. And there's Prop A, the funds haven't started coming in. But I definitely believe it's a blatant attempt at a 1% to try and privatize the university. Because academically, CCSF is just as strong as any community college in the country. As a matter of fact, won awards. But our academic,
I mean, the problem is not with the quality of education at CCSF per se, so much as that it's a shame that CCSF, which is probably the best community college in the country, has these endemic problems showing that, like, even coming to San Francisco and being surrounded by a community where people with master's degrees work at coffee shops, you'd think you could hire a decent community college for the rest of that. And you can, there are some good ones, no doubt, but, you know, it's... Same as all public schools from grade one on, it's very difficult to have better than a percentage. We really like those great teachers to change people's lives.
Well, I'm going to be one here pretty soon.
Yeah, we're going to keep...
Live streaming.
Nice.
At City College, we're doing our workshops.
Neat.
For people. It's not a for-credit class, but I want to get some young people out there and get them to show them how easy it is to live stream. But also, you know, technically... But there's a set of ethics that need to go with that, too, as well.
Yeah. And there's some other just basic things you need to understand, like...
Like knowing that you're a target.
Knowing that you're a target, knowing to...
Like, I know half these cops.
Get to know the cops a little bit before you go right up to them, because if they're in a bad mood, they might knock your sense of phone out of your hand.
Yeah.
If you're a community college student, you thought it was loan money, you're probably fucked. That's a big ball game right there.
Yeah, just little things like that.
So many people I know, the only piece of electronics they've bought new in the past 2 or 3 years is something that's got a smashed screen, and they're like, well, I don't buy nice things.
Well, they do offer insurance on my,
yeah,
my thing. But I'm pretty good with my tech. I managed to hold on to it pretty well. I'm there. I tried to drop my phone like twice since I've owned it. And it's been like well over a year now, so. And this phone is like, you could drop this phone and it's all like one piece solid. The only thing that comes off is the cover. I'm pretty happy. I got a LG Esteem. That works pretty well. Metro PCS. I don't have to worry about paying like through the nose for live streaming. $50 a month covers all the bill. And in San Francisco, their coverage is better than anybody else. I've been finding out with other live streamers.
Yeah, I did. I lost my unlimited data on my phone. I 4G is regulated differently at the time.
Right.
Well, my bill too. Went way down. It's combined between my hotspot and everything. They flip it all and it's still. And if you get close to going over, then you can just call in and upgrade the bill. There's no point in paying more than like the one that's the best deal.
Oh, stupid SUVs. Yeah. Well, not a very big crowd out here, but. Yeah, this band user software is the shit. Lets you know what your signal strength is, you can zoom in. It's got so many better features than Ustream. Because Ustream, I've noticed that. No, and it's like a little harder to do your social network, but I like it better, actually.
The recording quality tends to be a lot better because if you have shoddy signals, it's buffering.
Yeah.
So like if someone drives by with a 4G hotspot and they're watching Netflix, and they might skip on Ustream.
That's what I've been noticing. The quality of the band user is much better. But it doesn't like, sometimes I've been knocked off and you lose all that, you lose everything unfortunately. It's the only feature I don't like about it. Whereas Ustream automatically saves it for you, right?
It ought to, although it's not always.
Yeah, usually I've had, it's done pretty good by me on that.
Yeah.
But I hate all the goddamn commercials.
Yeah.
Like every time, I was like producing somebody's stream yesterday and I had to keep reloading the browser because, you know, they were on T-Mobile, which is a shitty company. And so I had to keep reloading the browser, and boy, they kept serving up those fucking commercials.
They used to pull the ads off our YouTube channel.
I've tried to contact them.
I talked to them a while back, and they were a few months ago. They were clearly like over half of their active users were us, and they were just like, it's really starting to be a problem for us.
And
so at some point recently, we all noticed that everyone went back to 10 gig of storage, everyone went back to having commercials, and almost everyone who had a free short URL lost it.
Well, no, they still have that.
Well, a lot of people lost it.
Yeah, I'm getting ready to hit them up for some cash, especially if I'm going to be doing workshops.
Yeah.
Right, because I'm bringing them new users, you know. That'd be worth something.
I think now, you can just email them, maybe now that you just have a meeting, and they'll say, here's all that
good. Yeah, if you're interested in it, let me know, because I want to do one at the main library, too, because they got Cred Auditorium.
Yeah,
you know, I'm building up to that one.
I'd be happy to.
Yeah, mainly for tech support, because we're going to need it.
It's a huge thing, you know, that it's like for events like this, for announcement events, it's good, but, you know, we have these incidents that happen, like,
especially
happen with Oscar Grant, and just like, you know, people that I know, when I'm hanging out with other people on the screen, if something happens that involves police, or something started wrong, you know, even if it's three people with their cell phones pointed, sometimes stuff is going on in other cities, and you hear about it on Twitter, and it's like, does no one have an iPhone? Like, App Store, Ustream, hurry up.
Right.
Still, you can probably install the app before whatever's happening.
Well, those are a lot of
training and get people to install the app, show them how to start it, have a login, and then say, now, it's three buttons.
There you go. Yeah. Matter of fact, live streamer exonerated somebody yesterday in New York from Occupy Wall Street that went to trial, and they used live streamer video to exonerate that person that he was not indeed breaking the law, and they got their charges dropped. So that's a positive aspect of live streaming.
Yeah.
And I generally consider my first job is to protect the First Amendment rights of the people that are out demonstrating. You know, I am recognized as press by the police. You know, I'm not going to carry around a press pass.
Yeah.
But,
I like the justice back there. Right. And you're not required. The Constitution covers everything that the press does. It can be that the word press is in there to make it clear.
Right. But I do have a press pass.
You know, there are times when I get...
When you need one.
And, you're like, okay, I'm really nervous about this.
Yeah, like FTP, right? They're doing a demonstration
this
Saturday.
Especially the anti-cap action, where I'm definitely just going to observe. And like, I'm like, I get how they feel, but I am not with them because I do not have a mask on, and I'm not going to be arrested, and I am not.
Well, at least I'm not going over there. I gotta have an electric chair. I can't be doing it.
Yeah.
I'm picking out one tomorrow.
So, you know, like, I'll walk down the sidewalk amongst the security. It's either part of the march or walking with the police at that point. And so, it's nice to have a press pass. One, so people don't think you're an undercover cop.
Yeah, right.
Because they're like, oh, because every once in a while, people are like, hey, look at that guy. He's over there talking to the cops. And I'm like, you know, sometimes I go talk to the cops. I'm like, hey, man, what's going on here? Why are you guys all the blah? Have you ever considered that this is a big waste of your fucking time?
What are they going
to
pay good money?
You get someone that'll go back and forth with you even when you talk to them like that, and sometimes you hear something interesting and make you feel disagree.
That's better than riding around in a patrol car.
I imagine so. It's like, yeah, okay. Just having them out of water and air and drum.
Well, that's peaceful right now.
Is that?
I said they're peaceful right now.
Yes. They're bigger than the crowd. And that's when they're happy.
Yep.
As soon as that tide starts to turn, you see them start to...
Well, there are a few more people.
Stations across the street and cars that aren't already parked here come sort of drive by and stop and talk to them, and then you see, like, a couple of vandals show up. They're not bigger than the protest.
Then it's the next thing you know.
Crowd control is not supposed to be having a bigger crowd than the crowd at top. It's supposed to be...
Now it's a waste of money.
Sure, yeah.
There's the expert about City College coming up. Hey, how you doing, Bob? No, no, it's Justin. Justin, this is Bob.
How you doing?
Okay. He's out here reporting on the protest.
I know you'd be here with the Israeli contingent.
I don't see any of them.
Yeah.
No, I'm just getting across the street. I get a better
yeah,
shot.
Really, yeah.
There's not much going on right now, anyways. Wonder if there's going to be a march. Generally, when they have these protests, they usually have a march. Yeah. Well, it's a good idea. It gets more visibility. Because, you know, after 5 o'clock, this place becomes a ghost town. I used to work in all these buildings down here. I hate every one of them.
You didn't happen to be at the CCSF thing yesterday?
No, I had a human was out there yesterday, Elijah.
Yeah, that's what I heard, yeah.
He was having a hell of a time with his signal. We're going to have to buy him a new phone and a different plan because T-Mobile doesn't cut it out there at City College. Right, Metro seems to work pretty well out there, so we're going to raise a little money for him and buy him a new phone. You know. And we're doing going to be doing a workshop. We've only got a room out there at City College. So we're going to be doing a workshop out there pretty soon on live streaming, which will be open to the public as well.
That's good, yeah.
So I'm excited about that.
Did you happen to show up at the AC last week?
Yeah, I was there.
I came, but I got there was some sort of thing with a fire.
Yeah, we couldn't get in.
When I finally showed up, nobody was there.
Yeah, everybody was down at the coffee shop.
I know. I missed the whole
thing. Yeah, I was a little disappointed because I wanted to go to a meeting.
Yeah, I wanted you to kind of talk about what you were doing.
Yeah, and evidently Dave wasn't. The reason why I was all locked up is because Dave usually gets to be.
Yeah.
And he's out of town. I don't know if he's still out of town. So. Yeah, I wanted to go for that. There was a few other questions, like we need to refocus on the financial institutions, you know, because still no banksters have gone to jail yet. And I've always found that these foreclosure defenses actually do the most good, and they shut down the bank. And it doesn't take a lot of people to shut down a bank at all, right? Maybe 5 or 10 people,
yeah.
You know, because I've seen it happen. I've live streamed, and it doesn't require a lot of advance notice or anything. And we need to start getting back to what we were, you know, it's all these other causes are really cool. You know, City College is really important.
Well, you know that there's one line that makes a lot of sense, that all roads lead to Wall Street.
Yeah, definitely.
And I mean, and the 1% controlling education, it's Wall Street, you know, so.
Yeah, so
I'm sort of making a plea over OBAL this weekend. I'm going to write something up, try to get people out there, get them a little motivated.
Yeah, get a little more motivated. Because all roads do lead, not just to Wall Street, but to the homes of the 1%.
Yeah.
You know, we need to go out and hit their houses and where they live. And then they'll see, you know.
I think there's some people organizing for that during the American stuff.
Yeah, because I know that there's 4 or 5 billionaires that live right here in San Francisco. So, you know, we need to show up on their doorstep, you know, and put the fear of God into them. You know, with the fear of the protest.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
That they can't get away with their slimy little bullshit.
One of the issues with that, I think, is that we did have a while where there were a few actors
who were like,
they
did have a...
You have to wait until people stop talking and talk. Stop talking and talk. There were actions for a while in the voice of Lichtenstein.
Yes, we did that, yeah.
And, I think that he was there at least once, but it's like, you know, you get... He's like... Study smoking a cigar, and the security guard gets a note, and you're like, do they even not just throw it away? And a lot of people in that, a lot of billionaires, like, they may own a home here, but not necessarily live here very often. And being able to figure out
when they're going
to
be here
is or what is interesting, and maybe even networking with people in other cities to say, like, let's have a welcome home party every time they land in one of the cities.
Right.
To really just sort of like make it so you can't get away, because I know one of the huge things we're concerned with about there being less, like, affordable, and by affordable I just mean normal people who want to rent an apartment
in San Francisco,
pay market rate, so be not even like people on disability or, you know, but
yeah,
just, like,
some security dead behind
people us. Who have jobs even that pay very well there are less, because they're trying to build these luxury condos for people who are jet setters who want to have a place in San Francisco and in New York and in Paris and in London. And I mean, I don't know what the solution to that is, because I don't really think that you should tell someone that they can't have an extra place, but there's definitely these people that are so overwhelmingly above what everyone else is within reach of achieving in 3 lifetimes. That
strange you're talking about that, because I'm working over near Dolores Park.
Yeah.
And it's a place that I've known these people for years. And he just mentioned that Zuckerman moved in around the corner, a $5 million home.
Yeah. Yeah, that's going to drive the price of studios rental down.
Yeah.
Obviously. Yeah, I heard about that.
Yeah, I'm not
pictures
a big...
Pictures started showing up with him at bars in the Mission, and people were just like, oh, fuck.
I wish I'd run into his ass.
Well, I've been walking down Valencia now on the weekend, and it's just like...
Oh, yeah, it's Yuppieville now.
Man, that used to be such a dead place, you know. Yeah, it's a hot set.
Yeah, they took away another place from us. You know, everybody was complaining about the hate. Well, the hate's gone. I don't even go up to Hate Street anymore. So, I used to go there. I used to live up on Hate Street. So, I won't even go up there anymore. San Francisco is a less and less desirable place every day. Can't afford to live here.
I feel like, you know, it's difficult for me to say as I'm out interviewing a tech company today, but, you know, the tech thing is a bubble. There's a bunch of people here who don't even like San Francisco and are here because it's a place where
that's the way where to work is.
There are other people like me who are like, I actually have flipped to the point where I just want to live in San Francisco and I happen to have these tech skills, so I want to go find a place who hopefully will survive when this great bubble bursts, and then I can move into a place. I mean, I think that the market's actually already starting to improve, even though you have all these things that should drive the price up, because last year, especially, landlords got such a horrible reputation in San Francisco for doing things like having an open house for an apartment that costs $2,000 a month charging people a $100 application fee and forcing them to bring their own credit report, and then just pocketing $10,000 from an open house and not running into anyone. And you can you can exploit people in that way only until word gets out. And then when I'm working somewhere, someone moves from the Midwest and they're like, where do I want to live? It's like, definitely not to see anyone work. You know, because it's off the chain, and so I think that that effect has been happening a lot, and now I'm seeing certain neighborhoods that are less fringy start to be a little more reasonable, because those landlords are probably seeing interest drop out faster, because they're not the mission, or like you look at Excelsior, or you look at, you know, places that if you live here, you know, like, oh, you see Excelsior, you can bike to Stonewall Church Street, totally. There's some hills in between you, but you just go around. But no one's like, I want to go party in your Tokyo or whatever. But you're like, actually, you could probably walk in many places. You could walk 6 blocks to the end of 24th Street and go hang out in Rio or whatever.
Yeah, Tokyo's not that bad, actually.
I think
I like it out there.
I think John Obelos could be a supervisor. So that's not the worst thing in the world. But, you know, I'm hoping that that's the beginning of the trend.
Yeah, he's at Bradley Manning. He's also, he's at Bradley Manning.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, we had a, there was a big demonstration for Bradley Manning last weekend. Poor Bradley Manning. Looking at 20 years now. Well, he's looking at life, but most likely he's going to get 20 years.
Well, it's 20 years on one court, but then they can take it to the military.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
I heard a very interesting thing today. Just a little fact. Robert Reich was talking about back in 1950, you know, the GM was the biggest company, the biggest American company then, right? And if you figure for a inflation, the average worker was making $50 an hour.
Right.
All right?
I saw a thing about that, about it, minimum wage. It was like that.
And right now, if you go to Walmart, $8.81.
Right.
And at least the GM had pension plans and health care, you know?
Right, there's no health care for Walmart workers.
He's done.
You know, they collect food stamps. Ridiculous. You know? When are Americans going to wake up? That's the question.
Yeah, I know.
Right? I ask that all the time on Facebook. When are you people going to wake up?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, whenever I write written, I'm all open-ended by Wake Up America. Absolutely.
Americans are so apathetic. Well, I'm getting ready to make a move here anyway. Move from San Francisco.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to move to New York for a while.
Nice.
Yeah, because I got a lot of journalism contacts there.
Yeah.
And that is the place to be if you want to be a journalist. You know, they got more resources. Like, I can have my own television studio and, you know, a guaranteed audience of 2 million, well, a potential audience of 2 million, one table. And then from there, I'm going to move to Spain.
Huh.
I'm going to retire there. It's going to be my retirement. And since I'm a German citizen now and I got a German passport, I'm eligible to collect German Social Security benefits there for disability. And they're much more generous, you know. And their medical care is a lot better in Spain than it is here. So just your basic medical care is much better. So I'll be the American expat in Barcelona.
Yeah. They're getting a fight with the neighbor over his dog.
Yeah, well. I'm living in the second ring. I live on a third ring. I live on a third ring of hell right now as it is, so
yeah.
Putting up with all kinds of crazy crap.
You know, I mean, you know, because John McCaffrey was...
Yeah. And believe...
...with his neighbor over his dog, you know, so cute, and... Something happened to dogs before he's into the guy got killed and he went on the run. Yeah.
And he's still on the run. You know, he came back and now he's got some woman with him.
Yeah.
You know. Crazy guy.
Huh?
Well, I'm talking about John McCaffrey. Not you.
Okay.
Now, Bob, you're one of the saner people I know.
Thank you, baby. I think the same to you.
Yeah, I was in a mood earlier today.
Yeah.
Yeah, I started watching RT and it gets me pissed off about America.
Oh, yeah, you know? RT is great, yeah.
You know? And then
You know who I like so much? Amy Martin.
She's good. I like Abby Hoppin. or Abby Martin.
Yeah, that's
breaking the set. Yeah. Yeah, she was
Amy,
an occupier.
Amy Martin.
No, Abby. Paul
Swift.
Abby.
Amy. Check it out.
I beg to differ.
All right.
She was an Oakland occupier, you know.
Huh?
She was an Oakland occupier.
Yeah, she lives over in Oakland.
Yeah, not anymore.
Yeah.
She's in D.C. now.
Yeah.
I've been keeping an eye on her.
Yeah.
Because when I go to D.C., I'm going to find out where she goes to.
I just find the issue that she brings up are the things that I really care about.
Yeah.
And nobody else is doing it. And
she's great.
So passionate with me, you know?
Yeah, Abby Hoppin. Abby Hoppin's one of my heroes, right? I just wrote a letter to,
Abby Hoffman.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
To Dana Beale.
Yeah.
Who was one of the original Yippies.
Yeah.
And he's in jail right now in prison in, Nebraska for marijuana charges. And he was, like, kind of, like, kept things going in New York.
Yeah.
They still have a Yippie Cafe there and everything. And when I was in New York last time, I made it a point to hang out there. And it's still there and it's still going.
Yeah.
And, they actually still have the property down on Bleecker Street, which was like the original Yippie headquarters. So I was glad of that.
Yeah.
But I'm not glad about Dana being in jail.
You've been to New York several times.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
But where are you from?
I grew up in Baltimore.
Baltimore, okay.
Right.
Which is kind of going down, isn't it, Baltimore?
No, well, I don't know.
So what I've heard recently.
Baltimore has suffered from an inferiority complex. But economically, they've been battered over the years because it was primarily a working class city.
They got a good congresswoman.
Yeah. They got good reps in the Congress and everything.
Yeah.
But, and they got the Super Bowl championship. That was a big thing for Baltimore. So that gave a little mark. Because Baltimore's trapped, you know, between New York and D.C. And that's kind of where the inferiority complex comes in. But it's actually a nice city. It's an affordable city. You can actually afford an apartment or a place to live there. Houses are still going for under $100,000 asking price.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of pluses. It gets cold there in the winter, and you do have four seasons.
Yeah.
But
some people like four seasons.
Some people like it.
Yeah.
Personally, it's a little backwards socially. You know, when I was there, I was hanging out at this bar in Charles Village. And I had this lady that came out and told me to stop talking politics. Right? I told her, you know, go to hell, you know, whatever. I just dropped $100 in this bar.
Really?
Right? I'm supporting your ass. So don't tell me what to do.
Yeah.
You know, I get real adamant about it. And that's, but that was kind of a downer about Baltimore. That, like, some people are so, like, closed-minded there. You know, and you go back there and there's areas that look just, people dress and look exactly like they did, like, at the beginning of the 1960s. Right, they got the beehive, bouffant hairdos.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And, yeah, they call them the Huns, right? Because they call everybody Hun, right? How you doing, Hun?
I knew this woman that worked in the Emporium Cosmetics, and everybody was Honey. And she said, like, you can't remember people's names, but they call everybody Honey.
But I won't be going back to Baltimore anytime soon. My family lives there, so.
You like New York?
I love New York. I just like all the people in New York. All the people on the street all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and people are a lot friendlier in New York than what, you know, than the stereotype. You can go up and talk to just about anybody there. That's what I love about New York. The people. It's a lively city. It's alive.
Well, the city is never sleeping.
Right. Yeah, I had a hard time. I'd go to bed at like 3 and get up at 6. Right?
I went there one time. I was coming up from North Carolina to visit my sister and her husband. It was a long time ago. And they had just been to New York. I wanted to see New York. They lived in Philadelphia. I mean, it was an hour away. And I was only there for a weekend. I didn't want to, you know, they had just gone the weekend before. I have yet to see New York.
They got a bus that goes there from Philly. Right, straight to New York. I'll meet you up at the Madison Square Garden. Right, you can, that's the cool thing about East, because they got the Chinese companies that run the Chinese buses that you can pick up in any Chinatown on the East Coast. And they only make like a stop in each major city. And it only takes about 4.5 hours to get from D.C. to New York. It's really quick, and it only costs like $20. So,
have you been to Philadelphia?
Oh, many times. many times. Philly's not a bad city either. They do suffer from an inferiority complex to New York. And New York, Philly's a huge city.
Yeah.
I mean, it's as big as the Bay Area, right? Yeah, I stayed at the, I like staying at youth hostels. And I stayed at the youth hostel they have in Fairmount Park in Philly, which is really nice. It's like you're almost down the middle of the country, it feels like, right? Fairmount Park is like Golden Gate Park in terms of size. So, but it's... Golden Gate Park is kind of sweet.
Is it a park? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's cheap. Yeah. Like, it's like $25. I do recommend the hostel in Baltimore. It's one of the best youth hostels in the United States. It's in the... Edgar Allan Poe used to live in that building. Same building, right? And it's all, like, renovated, but... They kept all the building is 200 years old, and they kept all the fixtures and everything, so it's really, like, historic, you know, and you get that feeling of being part of history there, and it's in a really great area of Baltimore, if you like to explore, you know, the history about what's going on, you know, and a lot of good nightlife around there, too.
I just saw a movie I couldn't get into. John Cusack playing Edgar Allan Poe.
Okay, all right.
I forget the name of it, but...
Well, he had a pretty dreary life.
Yeah.
You know, drug addict and alcoholic.
Yeah, reflected
in his writing, yeah. But he's venerated now in Baltimore, you know. I mean, they named the football team after him. The Ravens.
Yeah. I didn't think of that. It's interesting, yeah.
Yeah.
I know tonight is the return of FTP, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm not going to make that, unfortunately.
I'm going to try and make it because I'm interested to see...
It looks not too lively. I'm really divided about organizing protests on Facebook. You kind of, you know, it's kind of a crapshoot. Like, I've been to some where nobody was there.
Yeah.
And then I've been to some where they've been really huge. But you can never trust that... That list, because I've done it before, that people just click on it and they don't really realize that they're making a commitment to go somewhere.
Right. I don't ever believe those. I just use it as a way for people, you know.
Yeah, just to let people know.
There was a thing back, you know, a while back where there were like a couple of hundred people confirmed, but like 1,400 people invited. So you're like, okay, I mean, everyone has like heard about this now. Not much like stuff. The people who clicked join definitely read the page, at least the title, like flew by on their phone or something. The level of engagement is difficult to...
Yeah, it's super difficult, yeah. Not a lot of Palestinian folks with this project. There's a few.
I think some of them just say that some of these guys are hotel workers. So they often come during their evening lunch break for the project.
Well, I'll be out here until 6. Got another hour. Not that I'm in any rush. Well, we are lucky that we do have a lot of subjects to live stream.
True.
I could go out every day just about. I missed the one at the ACE protest that they had at Wells Fargo on Market Street. That was on Wednesday. I missed that one. And then yesterday I missed the CCS one, City College one.
That was, if you want to watch something, I think that it was filmed.
Yeah, dude, I watched the...
I was there. It was quite emotional.
Yeah, I caught the trustees, but it was starting to get a little hot and heavy inside the trustees meeting, too.
Yes, yeah. That's where I was.
Yeah, because they had it up, they actually had a live feed of that from City College. Well, I'll be there covering more and more stuff.
Yeah.
I really like the students out there that I met. You know, I thought they were really together.
Yeah, I don't think you showed up. I really appreciate that.
I really had that. And then one of my best friends, he goes to school there, so, you know, I have to support it. And just for the cause in general, you know, I'm actually overqualified. I can't take any classes there, right? But I still support the university and college.
Look at you alone.
I went to Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, which is the best medical school in the world.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And I studied pharmacology,
uh-huh.
So, you know, when I was a gifted student aid. I collapsed most of my, I went to college for 2.5 years to get a master's degree. So I haven't done anything with it other than set up a lab.
You know, it's funny, I went all the way through state here, you know, and there was a little group of us, maybe 10 or 12. Only one guy really got what he studied for. Everybody ended up in business or something, but it was unrelated to their major.
Well, I just don't want to go to prison. That's why I didn't, yeah. You know, because I'm not interested in working for any pharmaceutical company. But I do have I wrote my paper on LSD. It's like, you know, it's like right, how it can be used for psychotherapy. My old alumnus, I was pretty infamous back in those days, right? I supplied the whole university with everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I had to have guinea pigs.
Did you guys use Owsley as a name that you knew about?
Oh, yeah. Well, I had my own.
Yeah.
Right. And I was,
You know, I always, my experience were always good. And I used to, people used to want to invite me because, you know, people start to freak out, I could help them.
Yeah, because you're mellow, yeah.
But there would be guys, they would come down here on a gloomy, rainy day and, you know, in dark sections of San Francisco and then drop. And then they'd have that trip. I was like, no, you don't do that,
yeah. Yeah, you want to go someplace where it's nice.
Yeah. No, some of the most meaningful experiences I've had.
The most meaningful experiences in my life. Yeah, because I was doing a lot of work with entheogens. So I have like 6 patent pendings on different ones. And they were outlawed by the Designer Drug Addicts Act. And what really sucks is that it really has curbed any research in those areas, because I know that MDMA is very useful for PTSD. It's one of the best drugs you can give somebody.
Yeah.
And because they're forced to deal with that, the traumatic experiences in their life. Not in a bad way, but in a really good way.
Yeah.
And it would really help out some of the vets that are coming back from Iraq and from places like that.
It's outlawed.
It's outlawed, yeah. Actually, it's Schedule 3. So if you get the right shrink, it can be prescribed.
Okay.
So if you get the right shrink, you can get a therapy with it.
The name again?
Methyl-dioxy-methamphetamine. Which is the most interesting drug out of all these. Oh, yeah. Oh, a bunch of guys did. Robert Mitchum.
Mitchum.
You know, he actually went to jail for marijuana for a little while.
Yeah,
God rest his soul. Loved Robert Mitchum. I'm not too impressed by most of today's actors. Brad Pitt has actually come out publicly for marijuana, you know. He pretty much told everybody to fuck off.
You know what's interesting to me? The two most addictive drugs are alcohol
and cigarettes. Well, I quit drinking.
Yeah.
Finally. It took me a while.
I quit?
Yeah, well, you know, I'm not going to say I'm ever quit.
Yeah.
Well, it took me like 3 years. And then one day I just said, I don't know, I got to the point where they occupied and my increased activism is what really helped me.
Yeah.
Because you can't go to protest while loaded, right? And
you can.
Yeah, but I'm not about that, you know.
Yeah, I know.
As long as you can participate in are limited.
You seem that you can quit things when you have another thing to focus on.
I'm focusing on my activism and live streaming, and you know, I'm not drinking. And my life has gotten a lot better as a result, you know. Much better. I feel healthier.
Yeah.
Feel mentally healthier. And waking up with hangovers is something I don't miss.
Yeah.
But I was going to meetings. I didn't check myself into detox for a while because I was getting DTs.
Yeah.
And you know, I was putting away like a fifth every day.
Yeah.
Easily.
You know what amazes me is that Winston Churchill drank 2 quarts or two fifths.
That's why it was so fat.
He shaved.
Yeah, that's why
he
was so fat.
And then he had like 8 cigars or something, you know? That was his daily routine.
But, you know, I would drink, like, off toast. That's about as far as I go with it.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm back somewhere and somebody wants to have a toast, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, I'm not going to be, like, some people are, I'm never going to do it again.
Yeah.
But just the fifth-a-day habit's gone, and I really don't have any interest in it.
What do you drink?
Vodka.
Vodka?
Yeah. It gives you the least kind of hangovers. It's a little cleaner. And I like the good Irish triple malt whiskey, too. I still like that.
We'll go tomorrow. And,
And a draft beer, too, but that's about it. I don't want to do it.
I like that beer, you know, man, because it all kind of makes me. Having one glass, if it goes a little longer, it's more savoring and, like, you really get some numbers on it, not just, like, throw back to bourbon or whatever.
Yeah. But I'm under doctor's orders to, use marijuana at least 8 times a day.
You better listen to your doctor.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
You better. Well, I had leukemia a couple of years ago, and I didn't know it. And I was in D.C., and I was wondering why the fuck I was feeling sick all the time, right? And I wasn't using enough pot. Even though I was getting pot there, it was all crappy Mexican. And then when I came back here is when I broke this leg, and that's when I found out I had leukemia. And then the doctor said, and then about 6 months later, I got called in, and they asked me, you're in remission, and you're cured. And the only way they could figure it out was by marijuana use. You know, because I told my doctor I'm pretty honest about it.
Yeah.
And so that's pretty much what they attributed it to. And even though there was no, like, real proof.
Yeah.
But the only thing that I've been doing regularly for 38 years, 40 years now, is smoking pot every day.
Right.
So they told me to keep it up. So.
Yeah, when I first moved here, the first 2 years that I went to get my note, I already considered it to be medicine, but when I was in Texas, there was no point much in talking to a doctor about it. Read things and
you go to jail for a long
time. Yeah, I guess I do use it when I have headaches or my stomach is upset or this and that. And, you know, you go from just sort of smoking at parties to, like, you always have a bag around and you're like, oh, I feel like crap right now. I should maybe smoke a little weed. And then you're like, oh, hey, now concentrate. Then it feels good. Like, so I was talking to him, and I used to get terrible migraines, and I listened to those in my conditions for the first 2 years. And the third year, when I went back to see him, he was like, you know, he kept my file, of course, and talked to me about habits and diet and, smoke, you know, smoking cigarettes and drinking alcohol and, you know, put all your factors and take your blood pressure. So he pulled out the file, and he looked at the paper I just filled out for this year, the third year. And he sort of looks up from the paper and smiles at me and says, what happened to your migraine? And I was like, wow, I really cannot remember the last time that I had a migraine. And he sort of chuckled and he was like, you know, this is no study or anything, but every patient that I've ever had who puts down migraines, he was like, he needs cannabis regularly. Like, and he was like, in some people that means 4 joints a day, and some people need to one hit or twice a week. It's just the consistent thing that he found is that you just have some cannabis in your system on a weekly or bi-weekly or weekly or twice a week basis, then migraines tend to go away and stay away after 2 years. So he was like,
I wish I could say that.
Yeah, you know, and it's not everyone, but he was like, it's all the people who stopped saying migraine fit this pattern. And so he was like, you know, even if you cut back from how much you smoke now, which is time, you know, almost 10 years ago now, he was like, just remember that. But even if you're not, even if in 10 years you're not a guy, which, you know, I am, of course, but, you know, if you're not a guy who comes home from work and smokes a joint or whatever, just at some point during the week, once or twice, just smoke a little bit, because it'll keep the migraines away.
Yeah.
And you're going to smoke so much more if you get a migraine.
Yeah. Like, yeah, that's not always guaranteed to work.
You know? Yeah. One of the advice when I got to him that I remember the most, and the funny thing was, he lost his license because he was addicted to pills. And he was always very adamantly, like, if you told him you were prescribed any kind of pill, like, the, you know, for anything, I mean, other than, you know, antibiotics, anything that could be addictive, anything that was an opiate, he was just, like, very adamantly, like, you should use cannabis instead of that. And then when we all heard that he lost his license because he was addicted to pills, we were like, oh. Clearly, he said that because he did not want us to be in the situation.
Yeah, he was
like, this is miserable. He was like, but this is where I am. I'm addicted to
the doctor
I got access to.
Yeah.
So,
he was projecting his own problem onto other people.
Well, but also, you know, here's the thing. I mean, if you come in here and say, the good thing I always tell them is if I go to the dentist and they prescribe me codeine, like, I won't cash that in. I just use cannabis, and I ask the dentist one time a few years back, and they say, oh,
I cut a root canal and they're like, you can't smoke for a couple of days. And I said, is that because of the smoke or is that because of the nicotine? And the girl sort of looked at me and was like, it wasn't just she sort of looked at me and she was like, actually, it's the nicotine. And I was like, that's all I needed to know. Stop smoking cigarettes for a couple of days. No problem, as long as I can sleep while I'm laying in bed and, you know, swabbing out the shoes and all this unpleasant stuff. Because it works, you know, and same for anything. Where I had like a small procedure a few months back, and they were like, just give me antibiotics, I'm going to swim off. Like, they won't recommend it to you necessarily, like the insurance cover doctors, but they're just like, okay. I mean, they're not going to argue with someone who says, don't give me painkillers.
Yeah, yeah, no, that's not.
They're trying to identify drug-seeking behavior, and the easiest way to get antibiotics is to call a doctor, even if you prescribe antibiotics to the color.
They wouldn't give me the meter, I thought I was there.
Just like, hey, I have this problem, it hurts, but I just want antibiotics. They'll barely question you at home. Because you're like, I mean, what are you going to do? Antibiotics don't get too high?
Well, they discourage using them, though.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's what sometimes I get a half thing because. But they usually, often they'll ask me, hey, are you thinking you want antibiotics? And I'll say, well, I know that it's good to not have it too often. And they'll be like, well, I want you to have some, so I'm going to give you 5 days. Run through that. And the last time I did that, I actually ended up with a second run of antibiotics, like 2 or 3 weeks later. So,
well, I had a
next
pretty
time they say, do you want antibiotics? I'm going to say yes.
But there's antibiotics and a lot of stuff that we eat.
Yeah, there is.
You know, they just come through the animal.
Try to avoid that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I do, actually.
Am I wrong? Is anyone telling me that the Japanese consulate is actually over there?
No, the Japanese consulate's up in Japan now.
I'm sorry, the Israeli consulate?
Yeah, it's upstairs.
Yeah, because they're always over there. When you kind of screams.
Yeah, I know. I know, we usually got the troll, the Israeli trolls, Zionist, can't say Israel trolls, Zionist trolls, but they're not here today. And it's a small but enthusiastic crowd. Especially that one lady, she's got a voice. She'll be hoarse.
Oh yeah. Many of the people over there who you see who are less loud have been in her position in the past, including myself as well. Like,
yeah, I've lost my voice.
I'm just,
I can't.
I'm interviewing for jobs, you know, I can't. I have already once in the past, but it wasn't for protesting, it was the Giants for the series in 2010.
Oh, yeah.
And we were out partying in the streets for like 6 hours straight, and then you go to a job, people call about a job interview, and you're like, hi.
Yeah.
Then you're also smoking really heavily. And
yeah, because you're excited.
A lot if you're out drinking. And the smoking and the breathing deep and screaming is really just fucking so good. But yeah, a whole bunch of people over there who are a little confused. Like, we were out here in the rain and like, it's kind of, you know, it's been a little while, but it's good to rotate out.
Well, I'm glad everybody's watching out here. Let's see if we got any messages.
Maybe I'll see you at the AC.
Okay. Alright, take care, Bob. Bob's a really good dude. I like him a lot. He's a real dedicated activist. You know. That's what the best thing I've taken away from Occupy is that I met all these people that were involved that I kind of knew, but, you know, it's just like all these great activists that I met. And, inspired me to continue with mine because, you know, it's easy to feel alienated, you know, and you feel like, it's like, well, I organized my building, and, you know, I live in transitional housing, which is code word for welfare, and we're going to do social experiments on you, you know, and I've had to, like, literally kick the management's ass on more than one occasion, you know, legal threat, so. It's just nice to be involved with and reacquaint myself with other activists that I've known for the last 40 years. Like David Solnit, you know, I really respect. And a few other guys, people that I've known for you. Solnit.
Something I know. Yeah,
tall, thin guy with red hair.
One of the things that I love about the crime in San Francisco. As I move on, working on different issues and different movements, it's like my main focus is sort of stacking up things that I've already done.
Excuse me. Can I interrupt for 1 minute?
Okay.
Oh, yeah. How
are
you doing?
Pretty good.
Yeah? Yeah, good.
I'm feeling a lot better.
Good. Yeah, you look good.
Taking care of myself. Getting ready to get an electric car tomorrow, scooter.
Yeah, I'm going to get excited
if you guys
I
don't mind it.
I thought I was a Zionist
for
the
year.
Nah. I'm running on bicycle, that's good. Conversation went on, and said something about, I'm here filming. I said, yeah, the Israelis have been learning a little bit about live streaming lately, too, and she said, you're assholes. It was the greatest moment. I was like, that was like, that's exactly how I prefer for every conversation with someone that I commonly have to disagree with, and just by you being so frustrated at the raw facts of the matter. Up with the way that you want to look at things, so you're just like, fuck you.
Right.
Okay, love me, but all due respect, you're probably a nice person. I'm pretty sure that you're wrong. At least about the thing. That's really why we're here. I mean, after you talk to an asshole, maybe it's for their feelings more than this. But it's really just about, like, something we don't talk about enough. So.
That's
right. The prevailing voice when we don't talk about it.
Well, that's right. You know, that's what I like this one. Like, how many shows could
you
show today? Because that's what it's, you know,
mostly happening.
Wow.
Giving
the whole thing life. We got a few more people that have shown up.
You say to go!
I actually have more protesters than police.
Huh?
I said we actually have more protesters than police now.
When I got here, I thought, of all the demonstrations I've been to lately, well, the two or three, there have been a whole lot more people and a lot less police.
Yeah, they barely showed up in Valley Manning.
Man, you don't, you know.
Well,
you see them all the way down there.
Wells Fargo, too.
And there's so much more here. I mean, there's like, you know.
That was maybe 30, 35.
I guess there's no program.
No.
And the bullhorn didn't work. So.
No, no batteries, I'm going to imagine.
I was so fully afraid.
I was going to bring a bullhorn, and I didn't bring my extra battery pack on my phone.
Oh, yeah, I never go anywhere without extra batteries.
Well, I lent the batteries a while back.
I'm so glad everybody's watching. We're down here at the Israeli consulate, 456 Montgomery Street. If you're in the area, you should drop by. If not, thanks for watching. This is Free Man Sullivan. I switched over to Bandoozer instead of using Ustream. I like the software better. It's a little more robust. And it's easier on the batteries, too, because it allows me to see the screen, and the screen remains dimmed. This is a big plus.
Oh! The apartheid state is not to go!
I think her voice gave out.
I'm not regarding, but I got the longer I wait, the worse it gets.
Ah, oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm not looking forward to it. Huh? I'm not looking forward to walking home.
Have you been going to Occupy meetings?
I went to Action Council, but it didn't happen last week. It wasn't much of a meeting. But I'll try to go this week.
I kind of stopped going for a while.
A lot of people did. Well, we were trying. I want to try to get it more refocused back on what it's supposed to be about. Back in hitting the banks and financial institutions. You know, we need to get back to what we're about. You know, because those bank protests are easily the most effective thing that we've done.
And everybody gets it, has an interest. Hey, I'm going to go. I'm
going to
see it.
That's good to see
you,
too. Hope I'm going to again. Follow her on Twitter.
Oh, what is it?
Interrexa, right? With two X's. Yeah. Okay, take care. A little pause here between chanting. We'll go over, but there's really not much to see other than what you're seeing right here. I can see that there is a overload of police standing around on the... They should send away half of these cops. Nothing's gonna happen. Oh, let's check and see if we've got... Oh, nobody's commenting. Okay. Well. Anyway, glad you're watching. That's those conversations that we've had. Oh yeah, if you're in San Francisco and you're an organizer, show up at 209 Golden Gate on Sundays at 2 p.m. We have what is known as Occupy Action Council. I think we're dropping the Occupy off, but Action Council meetings from 2 to 4 p.m. every Sunday at the Local 2 Unite Here Union Hall at 209 Golden Gate at Leavenworth. And for those of you who are watching, we urge you, I don't know how much good it's going to do, but contact your congressperson and senator and tell them that you support defunding the Israeli war machine and ending U.S. military aid to Israel. That would be a good step in the right direction. I'm trying to think of products that come out of Israel that you could quit buying. I would just Google websites. There are websites out there and boycott Israeli products. Because you, as an individual, one of the most powerful weapons that you have is your ability to boycott products. One of the ways, the fastest way to bring down the 1% is the simplest way, just quit buying their products. And quit funding them, well then they won't be able to accomplish what they want to accomplish. So that's the easiest way. Quit buying their stuff. Oh, she's back. All right. People look it up out of the windows here. We're down here at 456 Montgomery. For a pro-Palestinian anti-Zionist protest. We're happy that you're watching. Do sign into chat if you have a question that I might be able to answer. It's absolutely beautiful evening out here in San Francisco. 60 degrees. Nice and warm. Not windy. I'll stick around for a few more minutes. Until the sun goes down. And you can tell it's getting to be spring. The sun's staying up a lot later nowadays. Yay, hey. Pretty mellow protest, actually, and I'm pretty sure there's not going to be a march, but I'll be here until 6 p.m., another 20 minutes. Thank you for watching. Please let your friends and neighbors know about my live streams. And if you're in the San Francisco Bay Area, look for an announcement about a live streamers workshop to be held at City College. And that'll be coming up in the next few weeks. So do keep an eye out. You can follow me on Facebook. I'm a Clark Sullivan, C-L-A-R-K-S-U-L-L-I-V-A-N. Or follow me on Twitter, at Freeman Sullivan. Or you can go to my website, activiststream.com. If you want more information. Pretty peaceful protest thus far. Definitely no arrest. Yeah.
William. Milling about. Looks like the demo's just about over with. People are wrapping it up. And like all protests, there could always be more people. So remember that public protest is guaranteed by the First Amendment. Don't let the police push you around, anybody push you around, or tell you that you can't. That's your right as an American citizen. At any rate. People are breaking up, it looks like. I'm getting to the point where starting to hear the call of nature. A lady in a Hummer. One of the most obnoxious vehicles ever built. Glad they went out of business. There's still a few people here, but by and large, the demonstration's broken up, it looks like. Just a few people left. And I'll be here until 6 p.m. For those of you that have embedded my live stream into your website, so 6 p.m. will be the cutoff time. Reposting it. I really appreciate it. I'd like to have as many people watching as possible. Crowd's thinning out a little bit. How you doing there, XPW317? Nice to hear from you. Thanks a lot for watching. Unfortunately, it came into the tail end of my stream here, because I'm getting ready to go off in 12 minutes. Not much going on here. It looks like it's breaking up. Unfortunately, it wasn't very well attended, but so there were people here. And if you want to block a building off, just let the police know about it and they'll block it off for you. Hey. Always good to hear from you. Yeah, I'm on Bambuser now. I'm not on Ustream anymore for the time being because I like the software, it's more robust. I could do more with it here. I'll show you some tricks here. Like it allows me to zoom. Woohoo. So
that's a feature I really like. And there's a few other ones I haven't really tried, but right now it seems to be working well. It even looks like the police are moving away. Some of the police are taking off. So it's pretty much just broken up. Let's see if we can zoom in here on this side. That way people can see it. There you go. By and large, it's broken up. There's still a few stragglers hanging out, but the police are leaving. And whether it was successful or not, we'll see. Police are removing the fences. So, yep. It's good to see that they don't view us as a threat anymore. So we're going to break up here. Looks like. Do follow me. I do at least 2 to 3 live streams per week on various topics, generally anti-authoritarian in nature. Hey, no problem. I'm at your service. So I'll be back next week. Do follow me on Facebook, Clark Sullivan, or on Twitter, at Freeman Sullivan, and so you can stay up to date. I can also check out my website, activiststream.com. I'm not accepting new members because I'm getting ready to transfer everything over to a new server, but do keep abreast of me by those means. And I'd like to thank you all for watching and your support. And this is Freeman Sullivan signing off. Thanks a lot for watching, everybody.